Hi, I'm James Bartolet, and welcome to the first episode of Old School Cool. Old School Cool is where you're going to see not only interviews with some great artists from back in the days, but also we're going to talk about trends and lots of cool stuff. So if you're a baby boomer or you love retro, you're going to love Old School Cool. And let's start off with our first segment, an exclusive interview from one half of one of the greatest rock duos of all time, John Oates from Hall & Oates, right here at the Sunset Marquee Hotel.
Sure.
So we're here in the Nightbird studio in the belly of the Sunset Marquee Hotel with my friends John Oates and Jed Lieber. Hi, guys.
Hey, I think we're doing an interview.
Yeah, we are. It's like we're just hanging out again.
We're working on the Ranger here. Now we're doing an interview. All right. That's cool.
This is a beautiful studio down here. Congratulations.
Thank you, James. Cheers. Yeah. Thank you. I'm proud of it. Yeah.
And speaking of proud, we're very proud of you, John, for your second solo album. And congratulations again on the BMI Award.
Oh, great. Well, thank you. BMI Icon Award was, you know, absolutely a very big honor because, you know, songwriting is for me the most important aspect of anything I've ever done. And to be honored as a songwriter is the ultimate accolade. So that's great.
Now, you two had performed at the Troubadour where you first played here in Los Angeles, right?
Yeah, Daryl and I did two special shows at the Troubadour because that was 35 years ago that it was our first gig in Los Angeles. We opened for Harry Chapin.
Wow.
So kind of a, you know, bit of a full circle, I guess it's called.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of going back to roots, this album is a return for your original roots, right?
You know, I started out as a folk guitar player. I was very much into the revival of the folk movement that was happening in the early 60s as a little kid. And I had a friend who had an older brother who was a folk guitar player. And he turned me on all this traditional American music, the child's ballads and, you know, and Joan Baez and Doc Watson and all the earlier people who were being rediscovered around that time. And I started playing a lot of that stuff and being involved in the Philadelphia folk movement in the 60s. Philadelphia Folk Festival was one of the early folk festivals after Newport. And then actually that was what I was doing before I met Daryl. So in a sense, I really wanted to kind of rediscover that part of my musical history.
And, now this album isn't folk music.
Well,
I mean, it's kind of blues, kind of gospel.
Yeah, it's modern folk music. It's folk soul is what it is. Yeah.
It's not going to be Pete Seeger or something.
No,
like
it's not Pete Seeger. It's what I do. It's the type of songs I write, the type of singing style that I have, filtered through R&B and through my experiences. And it's called Thousand Miles of Life, and the title sums it up. It's about, I don't think, it's the type of record I don't think I could have made without the 30-plus years experience I've had as a professional musician. So it's kind of, to me, it's kind of a culmination of all the things that have shaped me musically through the years.
And of course, you brought in Jed, who's been working
with
you. I
had to bring
in
my evil twin to cover the dark side. No.
Jed, you worked together on your first solo album, which was Feng Shui.
That's right. Yeah, that was our first experience where we were recording together. We had met and we had felt like we were kindred spirits on a lot of levels musically. And Jed helped me a lot with Feng Shui. And on this album, you know, as usual, his incredible keyboard playing and musical sensibilities are a very important part of this record.
Nice. And you have so many great guest musicians on here.
Yes.
God, you were telling me about Bella.
We got Bela Fleck on banjo and Jerry Douglas on dobro and lap steel, Sam Bush on mandolin. And these are, of course, that's the bluegrass side of things. And then we have John Popper from Blues Travelers playing a featured harp thing on this one song. Steve Cropper, who was, honestly, if I could play like two guitar players in the world, it would be Steve Cropper and Curtis Mayfield. So I tried to do that on this album on a number of occasions. So Steve is playing a couple tracks, and just a Bonnie Bramlett from the original Delaney and Bonnie group back in the 70s, and her daughter Becca Bramlett, who's just an awesome singer as well, was singing on it, and just great studio musicians as well. You might not know their names, but some of the cream of the crop of the Nashville session guys. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to do it in Nashville because I knew those musicians and those players, not only are they incredible players and musicians, but they know how to work in the context of songwriting, because in Nashville is all about songwriting, and also with singers. You know, they know how to showcase a singer and how to play together in an ensemble. And I wanted this record to be very organic, very real, very natural. So it was important that it was well recorded, and I used a top quality engineer named Bill Vorndick, who's an old school guy, has been around, you know, for a long time. And it was all about quality and uncompromising musicianship, and that's really what this record's about.
Well, can we listen to something right now? Is that okay?
Yeah, we can play something.
I mean, we're in the studio. I mean,
sure, we'll play a little Good Son if you want to hear it.
Oh, if you want to play that one. If you want to play that one.
Sure.
Right on. All right. An exclusive here for you today, right here in the studio. John Oates, Jed Lieber. Good Son. Unrehearsed.
All the tragedy that lives inside. All the sadness that he tries to hide won't keep him from coming to your defense, even if it is at his expense. And he may fall, but he will never run. He will fight your battles one by one. Yeah, he's a good son. He's a good son. Oh yeah. Good son. He's a good son.
What about the future John Oates and Jed Liebers out there that want to make some music? Is it a grim prospect for the future?
Well, not really. I think it's an exciting prospect for the future. I think the internet and the virtual world has opened many, many opportunities for
us. So we have to reinvent the wheel.
Well, I mean, the wheel is already reinvented and rolling. It's just whether you're able to ride on that or not, you know? Mm.
I'll tell you one of the most marvelous things that have happened. Everyone is focusing on how dismal the business is and the downloading and so on and so forth. But one of the greatest things that has happened as a result of all of this is that the filters have been removed from the record companies deciding what the audiences are going to listen to.
Oh, and that's a good point.
That is, that opens, that gives everybody an opportunity to be heard. And let the audience pick. You know, the audiences, let the kids, let the adults, let the different,
niche people, niche music lovers.
Choose what they love and what they think is good, because, back in the day, honestly, there were a handful of guys deciding who was going to make a record, and nobody heard anything else. And I think one of the most positive things to come from this is that that filter has been removed.
Yeah, right. I agree. That's a very good point.
Well, we had a great show, and I want to thank all of tonight's guests and, of course, you out there for watching. Till next time, I'm James Bartolet. And remember, the best school is the old school. Good night.